Chapter 4. J.R.D. Tata. J.R.D. Tata will forever be known for his obsession with aviation, but his early experiences growing up in Europe may have shaped his view of the Tata companies and of India, allowing him to ponder globalization long before chairmen of other corporations did so. Expansion was clearly the leading theme of J.R.D.'s tenure as chairman, and it greatly benefited the several Tata trusts that were established to more effectively distribute the wealth the company created. Following the death of Tata chairman Navroji Saklatwala in 1938, Jamshedji Tata's nephew, the leadership of the Tata group, passed to the next generation. Jamshedji Tata's cousin's son, Jehangir Ratanji Dadabhoi Tata, JRD, took the helm. With the company having passed through several years of financial struggle, JRD's mission was expansion, and expand the company he did under what would be a 53-year chairmanship. The business grew from 14 companies to 95, and assets ballooned from $100 million to more than $5 billion. If being named head of the largest industrial group in India at such a tender age put pressure on JRD to succeed, he responded spectacularly. Born in Paris in 1904 to a French mother, Suzanne Zuni Brea, and a Parsi father, Ratanji Dadabhoi Tata, JRD spent much of his childhood in France. French was his first language, and he subsequently became fluent in English, but he never achieved native fluency in any Indian language. If being raised far from India impeded his command of his ancestral language, it nevertheless broadened his global vision. It also affected his personal appearance. Unlike Jamshedji, who always wore the traditional white robe, cap and flowing beard, JRD possessed a clean-shaven chin, a trim Western hairstyle, and felt most comfortable in European-style suits. These externals notwithstanding, he and Jamshedji were nearly identical in their values, but not in all their interests. One of JRD's most memorable traits was a love of life, a consuming passion that contributed to his corporate legacy. After taking an aerial joyride at the age of 15, JRD was hooked for life. He avidly followed the career of his friend and neighbor, Louis Blériot, the great French aviator who, in 1909, was the first to fly across the English Channel. As soon as he could, JRD began taking flying lessons and soloed after only 3.5 hours in the air with an instructor. JRD was educated in France as well as in Japan and England. As a French national, he was required to perform service in the French military and was drafted into the army for a mandatory year. He took to the experience and actually wanted to extend his service beyond the required year so that he could attend the French cavalry's world-renowned equestrian school. His father forbade him. Although JRD was disappointed at the time, the paternal intervention saved his life. Soon after JRD left the army, his entire regiment was killed. While on expeditionary service in Morocco, JRD's goal after his military stint was to attend Cambridge University to study engineering. Again, however, his father stepped in, insisting that he instead come to India to work in the family business. JRD obeyed, but failing to earn the college degree he coveted was said to have haunted him for the rest of his life, despite his long success as the head of the Tata Group. He joined the company in 1925 at the age of 21 and was assigned as an unpaid apprentice. The following year, soon after his father died, JRD was elevated to the board of Tata Sons. Whether motivated by his father's passing or his newly discovered love of India, JRD renounced his French citizenship in 1929 and gave his heart to the country his father had loved so much, piloting planes and companies. While learning everything there was to learn about his family's business was important to him, JRD continued to pursue his flying career. In 1929, he became India's very first recipient of a pilot's license. Just 3 years later, in 1932, he founded the nation's first commercial airline, Tata Airlines, with an investment of 200,000 rupees, about $45,000 in today's times, from Tata Sons, which was sufficient to purchase 2 second-hand airplanes. The pilot was the first commercial flight ever made in India was none other than JRD, who personally flew a cargo of mail from Karachi to Bombay. By the end of its first full year of operations, Tata Airlines' 3 pilots, JRD among them, transported 155 passengers and nearly 11 tons of mail, a total of 160,000 miles. In 1946, Tata Airlines went public and was renamed Air India Limited. 2 years later, in 1948, JRD founded Air India International, the nation's first international airline. 5 years after this, the Indian government nationalized Air India, much to JRD's dismay. He was, however, appointed chairman of Air India International and made a director of the board of Indian Airlines, the country's domestic carrier. Under his leadership, Air India rose to global prominence. Nationalized or not, Air India was always his baby, his first love, and JRD remained on the board for 25 years. In recognition of his contributions to Indian aviation, JRD was given the title of Honorary Air Commodore of the Indian Air Force in 1966 and was promoted to Honorary Air Vice Marshal in 1974. It was perhaps his proudest honor. To be sure, JRD took over as Tata chairman with less experience than his predecessors. Yet his moral compass was totally aligned with theirs. Like Jamshedji, Dorabji and Navroji, he was committed to succeeding without stooping to the unethical behavior all too common in the enterprises of developing countries, the use of bribery and the black market. Such practices, he made clear, would never be the Tata way. Fair and honest were his watchwords. Success breeds success. Although JRD was a member of the Tata family, he recognized that Tata Sons could not realize its full potential for expansion and profit if it continued strictly as a family business. He therefore boldly broke with tradition and instead of automatically putting family members in charge of the many Tata companies, he hired the best of the best. He wasn't afraid to pay for talent either. He once joked that the Chinese chef he had hired to work at the Taj Mahal Hotel earned more than he did and that he believed was precisely as it should be. Of course, there was a downside to handing over authority to outsiders. Over time, disputes arose that threatened Tata's growth and ongoing success. Fortunately for the chairman and his firm, however, JRD knew when and where to take back control. One company that grew notably under his leadership was Tata Chemicals. In 1939, JRD purchased an Indian chemical manufacturer that had been founded in the 1920s. Transforming it into a Tata company had its challenges, including the bombing of a cargo vessel transporting raw materials to its plant. But as usual, JRD persevered. Still, it was 1944 before soda ash production began. With an initial capacity of 18 tons per day, today Tata Chemicals soda ash plant produces 2,500 tons per day, making it the second largest producer in India. In addition to Tata Chemicals, JRD initiated, expanded, purchased or led the way for such key Tata companies as Tata Electric, Tata Motors, Titan Industries, the cosmetic company Lakme Voltas, a major marketing, engineering and manufacturing firm, Tata Global Beverages, Tata Exports, today called the Tata International, Tata Precision Industries and TCS, often described as the jewel in the crown of the Tata companies. Philanthropist in training. Even before rising in the Tata Sons hierarchy, JRD was named trustee of the Sir Dorab Tata Trust in 1932. Coming so early in his career, his involvement in philanthropic work likely influenced his bold and energetic leadership style at the head of the firm. As key decision maker for the trust, JRD was instrumental in establishing, in 1941, the Tata Memorial Center for Cancer Research and Treatment, the Bombay region's very first cancer hospital. Under his direction, the trust also funded the Tata Institute of Social Sciences in 1936, the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in 1945, and the National Center for the Performing Arts in 1966. While JRD labored to improve conditions for all Indians, he was especially concerned for the welfare of Tata employees. Through the years, he instituted internal policies to care of and protect the company's workers. He also created programs to provide free medical care, retirement funding, and workers' compensation. In 1979, Tata Steel took the radical step of legally stipulating that Tata workers were the company's employee from the moment they left home for work until they returned home again. This extended worker liability insurance coverage was in a manner almost unthinkable even among the most enlightened employers of today. Like his predecessors, JRD was passionate about improving the lives of the people who worked for the company. In a firm as large and complex as Tata, JRD could hardly establish a relationship with each and every employee, but he gave his full attention to whomever he spoke or interacted with. Such certainly was the case one afternoon when JRD, then in his late 80s, stopped to wish his younger sister, Rodape Soni, health, wealth and prosperity on the Parsi New Year. She was at the time widowed and living alone in the Taj Mahal Hotel. While JRD was with her, the hotel housekeeper summoned the courage to suggest to him that perhaps his sister could be moved to a sea-facing room, which would give her the opportunity to watch the bustling activity on the water. I'm sure the hotel would not charge extra for it, she assured JRD. The remark rubbed him the wrong way. What do you mean the hotel would not charge extra for it, he demanded. The Tata do charity. They do not take charity. The housekeeper was mortified, but if she had the rest of her shift to ponder her gaffe, apparently so did the Tata chairman. When the housekeeper left work that evening, a car was waiting at the back gate. Giardi was at the wheel. I wanted to apologize for my outburst, he told her. May I drop you to your home this evening? Pulling up to her house, he told her, I didn't want you to have a miserable evening thinking about the incident. Good night. Most leaders would not have given the exchange that afternoon a second thought. The man's life story is filled with many similar anecdotes. Parallel goals. Like Jamshedji Tata, Giardi viewed the future success of Tata's sons as inextricably linked with that of India. He was thoroughly committed to helping India achieve progress in education, in the eradication of poverty, in quality of life, and in health. He donated a sizable portion of his personal wealth to establish some of the best research facilities and educational institutions in the nation. Among the organizations Giardi endowed was the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, which he helped establish in 1945. Its mission was to become a scientific institution to rival the best in the world, as well as to discover and share beneficial findings with India. It was not founded solely as a research institute, but as a means of actually delivering the benefits of scientific breakthroughs to a large population, curtailing population growth. One of Giardi's biggest concerns for India was its out-of-control population growth. Whereas Prime Minister Nehru believed India's population was its greatest strength, Giardi saw the connection between overpopulation and poverty, and he worked to reverse the trend. He donated generously to the study of population control and founded what would later be named the International Institute of Population Studies. For this and all his years of work towards population control, Giardi received the United Nations Population Award in 1992. Like Jamshedji and Dorabji before him, Giardi was an ardent supporter of women's rights long before it was widely accepted cause in India, and he put his beliefs on the issue into direct action. In 1974, Sudha Murthy was earning her master's degree in computer science at the Indian Institute of Science, the only woman in her postgraduate department and one of the top students in the program. She was considering accepting an offer to earn her PhD in the US when she happened to read an ad on a campus bulletin board for a job at Telco, today's Tata Motors. The notice infuriated her. Telco was looking to hire young, hardworking engineers with excellent grades, yet the last line of the ad specified, "Lady candidates need not apply." Murthy understood that as a female computer scientist, she was a rarity, and not just in India at the time, but she had never faced so blatant an instance of gender discrimination. Livid, she fired off a letter to Telco to let them know what she thought of the anti-females policy. It was not that she actually wanted the job, but she was incensed that she was being excluded from consideration solely on account of her gender. She didn't know who was in charge, but she did know that Giardi Tata was the chairman of Tata Sons. And so she addressed a postcard to him, chastising him for allowing such discrimination to occur. About a week after she posted her missive, Murthy received a telegram inviting her to an all-expenses-paid interview at Telco's offices in Pune. Stunned, she gave in to the urging of her friends and accepted the offer. As she seated herself before a committee of six, she overheard one of the members say, "This is the girl who wrote to Giardi." Assuming this was a fatal mark against her, she decided she had nothing to lose and answered the committee's questions rather flippantly. To her amazement, at the end of the interview, she was told the job was hers if she wanted it. Sudha Murthy had never met the man, but Giardi Tata had surely changed her life. His goal, however, was to change the lives of many. In pursuit of the same, he set up the Giardi Tata Trust in 1944. A few years later, he sold some of his shares in Tata as well as an apartment in Bombay to fund the Giardi and Thelma Tata Trust, which is dedicated specifically to improving the lives of India's disadvantaged women. He and his wife Thelma never had children, though it is said that Giardi seemed more comfortable around them than he appeared to be in the company of any adult. Well-deserved recognition for his efforts to improve the working and living conditions of Tata employees and customers, as well as all Indians, Giardi earned a long list of honors. In 1955, he received the Padma Vibhushan, the second highest civilian honor awarded by India. In 1988, it was a Guggenheim Medal for Aviation, and in 1992, the Bharat Ratna, India's highest civilian honor, as well as the United Nations Population Award for his work initiating and furthering India's family planning movement. Giardi died at the age of 89 in Geneva in 1993 and was interred at Père-Lachaise Cemetery in his native Paris. In India, on the day of his passing, Parliament was adjourned, an honor typically reserved for former leaders of Parliament. Every member of that body knew, however, that Giardi's influence had reached further and had achieved more for India than most of India's politicians.